Amen. And good evening and welcome to our Maundy Thursday service this year, again on Zoom. Welcome to you, if you are male or female, or a little bit of each, LGBTQ or straight, or a little bit of each, black or brown or white or red or yellow, or a little bit of each, old or young, or a little bit of each, rich or poor, or a little bit of each, doubting or believing, or a little bit of each, member or visitor, or a little bit of each, immigrant or citizen, or a little bit of each, have an able body or a disabled body, or a little bit of each, in recovery or recovered, or a little bit of each, feeling connected or disconnected, or a little bit of each, feeling isolated or overstimulated, or a little bit of each. No matter who you are or where you are in life's journey, you are welcome here.
To a dark Gethsemane, all who feel the tempter's power, your Redeemer's conflict see, watch with him one bitter hour, turn not from his griefs away, learn from Jesus Christ to to the judgment hall, fear the Lord of life arraigned, oh, the reward of all, oh, the pangs his soul sustained, shun the suffering shame on us, learn from Christ to
encounter six people who had front row seats in this incredible real life drama. Mary, friend of Jesus, Simon Peter, Judas, a Roman soldier, Mary, mother of Jesus, and Salome. Sometimes this story feels only like a story to those of us who have heard it so many times, but it was real. It was painful and rich and life-changing for generations and generations of Christians after it. But how much more so for those who lived then and loved this man named Jesus. Just as we have found that there are gifts in the wilderness, these people perhaps also found their place in the world, their true calling, as a result of a walk in the wilderness of life. Let us allow these ancient people to call us more deeply into our faith story.
Six days before Passover, Jesus came to Bethany, where Lazarus lived, whom Jesus had raised from the dead. Here, a dinner was given in Jesus' honor. Martha served, while Lazarus was among those reclining at the table with him. Then Mary took about a pint of pure nard, an expensive perfume. She poured it on Jesus' feet and wiped his feet with her hair. And the house was filled with the fragrance of the perfume. But one of his disciples, Judas Iscariot, who was later to betray him, objected. Why wasn't this perfume sold and the money given to the poor? It was worth a year's wages. He did not say this because he cared about the poor, but because he was a thief. As keeper of the money bag, he used to help himself to what was put into it. "Leave her alone," Jesus replied. "It was intended that she should save this perfume for the day of my burial. You will always have the poor among you, but you will not always have me." Meanwhile, a large crowd of Jews found out that Jesus was there and came, not only because of him, but also to see Lazarus, whom he had raised from the dead. So the chief priests made plans to kill Lazarus as well, for on account of him, many of the Jews were going over to Jesus and believing in him.
I was in the middle of the marketplace that day, and it hit me like an overwhelming wave of feeling. I loved him so much. It was a love beyond anything I'd ever known. Not romantic, not like a sibling, certainly like family, but he was so much more to me. He was teacher, he was priest, he was wise one, he was hope itself. And for the first time in those days before the terrible thing happened, I felt he might not be invincible. He had told us, he had warned us, he had been saying this could happen all along, but I just couldn't imagine it. He was so eternal, it seemed, like nothing, not even God, would dare to take him away from any of us. But the tension was building. "I will beg him," I thought, "to not go to Jerusalem, just go back to Galilee. Go to the hills, go to Nazareth, go anywhere but Jerusalem right now." But even as I thought it to myself, I knew that he wouldn't go. This is where he was supposed to be. With all these people gathered for Passover, Jerusalem is where he had to be. And I knew he might never leave. I suddenly became aware that I was standing stock still, oblivious to all around me here in this marketplace, and I began to double over with fear. But just as I did, my eyes came to rest on the stall to my right, a jar, a most beautiful jar of anointing oil. The seller offered it to me for a price that seemed outrageous, and I didn't care. No price could compare with the price my teacher, my master, would pay. And so I bought it. Whether in life or in death, my beloved friend would need it.
Thank you.
Mary's anointing of Jesus belonged to the tradition of honoring someone with sweet-smelling oil made of a combination of many herbs. This was used at the consecration of kings and also as anointing for burial. In this one act, Mary offers signs of love and honor. The early Christians then used the same scented oil as part of their baptismal and confirmation rites to emphasize their new identity with Christ, which also means anointed one. So tonight, inspired by Mary's act, we anoint each other's foreheads as those early Christians did with a sign of the cross and the words, "You are God's beloved child."
Jesus knew that the Father had put all things under his power, that he had come from God and was returning to God. So he got up from the meal, took off his outer clothing, and wrapped a towel around his waist. After that, he poured water into a basin and began to wash his disciples' feet, drying them with the towel that was wrapped around him. He came to Simon Peter, who said to him, "Lord, are you going to wash my feet?" Jesus replied, "You do not realize now what I am doing, but later you will understand." "No," said Peter, "you shall never wash my feet." Jesus answered, "Unless I wash you, you have no part with me."
He continually baffled me. My whole time with him, one surprise after another. Jesus turned my world upside down, especially when it came to relationships. We would worry about who was his right-hand man, and he would always turn it around with his last shall be first stories. I wanted to know where I stood with him. I needed for him to be my Lord, my master, my teacher, and he was. But then he went and did this that night. Now, none of us were of really high lineage, but we weren't slaves or servants. I mean, at the meal that night, there were people to wait on us. This is service that just comes with any good room rented out for a meal. But I had planned to wash his feet that night. I was overwhelmed with love for him and fear for his life. I had this nagging need to show him, demonstrate to him, that I would do anything for him. But before I could even begin, he knelt before me. He insisted on washing my feet. I was horrified. I thought maybe he was losing his mind. One more time, he reversed the way I thought things would go. He just kept doing that. He said to me, "You can't be part of the family of God, the kingdom of God, Peter, if you don't let me do this." As if I couldn't see that he really meant what he said about serving our neighbors, our friends, and our enemies. He always kept me off balance. I thought I knew what he meant, and then it seemed like I just wasn't getting it. I had to surrender all my preconceived ideas about how relationships are, how they go, who we love. I had to surrender and let his loving act of washing my feet heal my soul and heal every disappointing relationship I'd ever had.
Jesus used water to model the kind of love we must have for one another. A love that serves the least of our brothers and sisters. If you have a bowl with water, put it in front of you now. If you need to get that, do so now. If you are washing together as a family or group, you are invited to wash each other's hands as you are able. Then use your towel to dry your hands. In this time of pandemic, washing our hands is a sign of love and care, not just for ourselves, but for our neighbors as well. Let this be a symbol of our commitment to love our neighbors.
So friends, if you have some water or even some hand sanitizer, you can wash your hands in a symbolic way. Unfortunately, we can't wash each other's hands today, but we're still washing our hands and wearing masks and getting vaccinated because we love our neighbors and we love our families. So we continue to do this as a sign of love for each other.
After he had said this, Jesus was troubled in spirit and testified, "Very truly, I tell you, one of you is going to betray me." His disciples stared at one another, at a loss to know which of them he meant. One of them, the disciple whom Jesus loved, was reclining next to him. Simon Peter motioned to this disciple and said, "Ask him which one he means." Leaning back against Jesus, he asked him, "Lord, who is it?" Jesus answered, "It is the one to whom I will give this piece of bread when I have dipped it in the dish." Then, dipping the piece of bread, he gave it to Judas, the son of Simon Iscariot. As soon as Judas took the bread, Satan entered into him. So Jesus told him, "What you are about to do, do quickly." But no one at the meal understood why Jesus said this to him. Since Judas had charge of the money, some thought Jesus was telling him to buy what was needed for the festival, or to give something to the poor. As soon as Judas had taken the bread, he went out, and it was night.
I was so angry with him. Why wouldn't he fight? We had so many followers by this time, and so many were in Jerusalem right now. Why did he insist on this "blessed are the meek" stuff? I think all along I had hoped that this was the revolution, that we would finally stand up to the Roman occupiers. And he had such power and charisma. Couldn't he have done anything, this son of God? I suppose my bitterness finally took over. I had kept it all inside for some time, and it had started to boil and rage until I just snapped. If I couldn't get my revolution, I could get out. I was tired of holding the purse for this motley group of people who gave it away as soon as it came in. And then I discovered I could get out with some money from those dirty Romans. It all happened so fast. They approached me, they'd seen me, watched me, perhaps read my indecision, my anger, my separation at times from the group, and it just happened. And then there I was at the table, his table, knowing what I had set in motion. All of a sudden, I was flooded with panic as we sat there. The air felt heavy with fear and unknowing. At the table again. It reminded me of all the meals in our years together. Sometimes just us, this small band of disciples, but often with someone Jesus had invited to dinner, someone we couldn't believe, yet again, he was hanging out with. Sometimes it was hard to understand. People who took advantage of others, people who had no interest in supporting him, people who questioned him, people who were beneath him. Really, he invited anyone to the table, the bottom feeders. And then I realized as he stretched out the cup of wine to me and dipped the bread in it, that he saw right through me, knew my thoughts. He was doing it once again, inviting a scoundrel to dinner. Only this time it was me. He was offering to share the cup and break the bread with me. He would never have hurt anyone. He loved us all, even the lowest of the low.
Mm-hmm.
Friends, just as Jesus did not hesitate to share the cup of wine with Judas, who he knew would betray him to the authorities, Jesus invites all of us, no matter our pain, our despair, our failures and faults. Jesus says, come and eat with me, for this grace can transform you. And so this night, you are invited, just like in that Last Supper, to share the food that nourishes our spirits on the journey. We remember his words that echoed that night to his disciples and that have echoed through the ages. I am always with you.
Friends, if you'd like to unmute, feel free, but there is no requirement or obligation to do so. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift your heart, let your hearts be lifted even in the heaviness of your sorrow and fear.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right
to give our God thanks and praise.
In the midst of the events of the last week, the disciples had really floundered. It started out fine with excitement, really, as they had entered Jerusalem with crowds following along, singing and shouting, Holy,
holy, holy, holy, holy,
holy Lord,
God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory.
Hosanna in the highest.
Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord.
Hosanna in the highest.
That excitement turned to doubt, questions, confusion, fear. This Jesus was the one who had proclaimed a message they could all believe in, the disciples thought. This was the one who had come to fulfill the scriptures, to proclaim release to the captives and recovering of sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who are oppressed, and to announce that the time had come when God would save the people. And then the moment had come, the moment when Jesus said the words on that night that he gave himself up for the message of peace, of hope, of justice. The night he gave himself up for us, he took bread, gave thanks to you, O God, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples and said, take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. And for the first time, his next words sent a chill down their spines. Do this in remembrance of me. And when the supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to you, God, gave it to his disciples and said, drink from this, all of you. This is the cup of the new covenant poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. We eat and drink of this meal tonight, especially remembering the death of Jesus. But we also know the rest of the story. We know that what emerges from death is always life. And so we proclaim this night to each other in the world that Christ has died, Christ is risen, and Christ will come again. If you have your elements, I invite you to hold them up and be in a spirit of prayer. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here this night, O God, just as you did on our ancient ancestors. Pour out your Holy Spirit on these gifts of food and drink. Let them be for us a reminder of the brokenness of our world, so that we may be for the suffering world the body of Christ, liberated by his witness, passion, and resurrection. Let us die to the ways of injustice so that we may live again in your promise. Let us be inspired to proclaim hope, peace, love, and justice in your name. By your Spirit, O God, we are one with Christ, whose memory, whose presence was real to his disciples and is real to us even now. By this Spirit, we are one with each other. Let this love be seen in us outside of this place, and all God's people say, amen.
Amen. Amen.
And so, friends, I invite you to eat your food. And then I invite you to drink your beverage.
Mm-hmm.
After dinner, they went to the Garden of Gethsemane and Jesus prayed. And then the soldiers came and they arrested Jesus. They took him to the council and to the governor's palace, where they tried to make it look like a trial, but it wasn't. And then finally, they led him away to the place where criminals were hung, always on crosses, so that they would die slowly, painfully. Jesus was hung between two other crosses, bandits on each side of him. And the sign over Jesus' cross said, "This was the King of the Jews."
The scene was horrifying. Not that I wasn't used to crucifixions. They were the favorite way of putting prisoners to death by the Romans, and so I'd assisted many times. But I'd heard about this man, Jesus. We thought Barabbas was going to be on this cross, but the crowds had become almost out of control, and I'd heard that Pilate simply washed his hands of it, sent this one to die just to shut them up. Who knows what these crowds really were screaming about? There was so much confusion and rumor. No one will probably ever know the truth, is what I think. But when the reality hit his followers that Jesus was really going to die, and they saw him heading to Golgotha with the cross, the horror really began. Even the heavens seemed to be wailing as storms began to appear. It gave me a chill, I'm going to tell you. These are not things I want to tell you. I'm a soldier. But it is always easier protecting others than protecting yourself. From the mothers who beg for mercy for their sons, from those who insist on waiting the hours and even days it takes to die this agonizing death. Being a soldier can't always protect you from what you witness firsthand, like hearing Jesus talk to the prisoners on the other two crosses next to him. The promise that death is not the end for them. And then he looked at me, right at me, and spoke the words I'll hear for the rest of my life, and the words that mean I can no longer do this job anymore. "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." Later, after he died, they pierced him in the side. I still don't understand why, but in that moment, I knew that he was truly the Son of God. His blood poured out just like the love he poured out for his people. The blood flowed from his side. The blood flowed. The love flowed.
My son, from the moment the angel said to me, "You will bear a son," my life was no longer my own. And yet it was every bit mine. Moments treasured, remembered in my heart alone. Every moment he grew within me, every day of his youth, every movement of his ministry from that day at Canaan to this very minute. At times, the pain of watching him give his life away seemed harder to bear than the wonder of this unimaginable life God had given me. And especially now, in this moment, I am not just the mother of Jesus shedding tears for my son. I am the tears of any mother who has seen their child die before them. I am the tears of every mother who has lost children in war and injustice. I am the tears of all loved ones who cannot save their loved ones as they starve or are taken by illness or injury or are swept away in a tsunami or a flood. I know the tears of mothers whose children lose their lives to addiction or are consumed by depression, or who are lost to violence. And I am the tears of all those who did not know the fate of the missing ones. I am the tears.
Mark's gospel mentions our last character at the scene of the cross. Some women were watching from a distance. Among them were Mary Magdalene, Mary the mother of James the younger and of Joseph, and Salome. Salome later accompanies the women to the tomb.
I was there at the cross, just as I had been there for the last several months, one of his many followers. But I was not just a follower. I was companion to Mary, friend of Jesus, and the other Mary, mother of Jesus. And at this moment, they truly needed a friend. So many of the followers had fled as soon as the guards had come to the garden that night. But I could not leave. I would stay with my sisters, my friends, at the cross, and through the agonizing depth of Sabbath, keeping stillness until it was time to anoint and prepare his body for burial. I knew how to tend to the dead. Tending to his body would perhaps help me find comfort in the darkness, there in the tomb with the memory of him even in his lifeless body. I would let my movements carry me into a future I was afraid I could not face. And so I kept my lamp close so that I could light it and lead us to the tomb after the Sabbath had passed. But that is a story for another morning. For now, I carry the lamp to keep us company in this vigil. For I know deep down that nothing can snuff out the light, the hope that he gave to all of us. We carry it within.
Thank you.